Hi guys, this is the second video in the Full Stack Elixir series. In the previous video, we have started our project by creating a new Phoenix application, setting up a database schema, and implementing a simple GraphQL API. If you haven't watched that video, you can either go and watch it, or you can build upon the source code of the application, which is available on my GitHub account. Now that we have got our backend application up and running, we can start implementing the cool part, which is to say the React application. We will have to configure Webpack to transpile our JavaScripts and bundle CSS. This is slightly more complicated than using a generator like Create React App, but it's not all that hard because the Phoenix framework has already generated a simple Webpack config for us, and the file structure is correct. And my personal preference is to use Babel with a plugin for TypeScript. For the styling, I will not be using any CSS framework such as Bootstrap or Tailwind CSS. Instead, I will write most of the style sheets by hand, and I will be using Sass, which is a CSS preprocessor to facilitate this task and to add some neat features, such as variables and nesting. So let's go to the terminal and get our hands dirty with some actual work. And here you can see what I have cd'd into the application directory, and from here I will cd into the asset subdirectory, which is where the frontend files live. And let's open the Webpack configuration file. I will be using Vim, but you can use any editor you like. And when you scroll down 20 lines to the module section, you will see that Webpack is already configured to transpile our JavaScripts using Babel. However, we will still need to configure Babel to understand React and to transpile TypeScript. So let's jump to another terminal window. And in here, I will need to install several libraries. And I will install them using Yarn. And if you don't know what Yarn is, it's basically a package manager, and it's kind of similar to npm. So if you are using npm, do remember to switch this yarn add to npm install. So I will now add three dev dependencies, and these will be two Babel presets and the TypeScript compiler. So yarn add dash capital D, add Babel, preset React, add Babel, preset TypeScript, and then the TypeScript compiler. And now we have to install React and React DOM. So these will be production dependencies. So it's yarn add React, React dash DOM. And since we are planning to use TypeScript for React, we still need to add typings for React and for React DOM. And now we need to tweak some settings inside assets/webpack-config.js. So one thing that we have to do is add the settings for module resolution, because this way Webpack will be able to find our modules if they live inside TypeScript or JSX files. So I'll jump 10 lines above, and it can basically add it anywhere inside the main object, but I tend to add it after the optimization section. So I will add a new section called Resolve, and inside it extensions. And in here it will be four file extensions, and they will have to be preceded by dots. So it's extensions .js, .jsx, .ts, and .tsx. And you have to make sure that the file is syntactically correct. So after this section, I add a comma. And afterwards, in app, this entry section, here it will be using slash app.js. However, our main file will be converted to TSX, so for now I will just change it to .js/app.tsx. And then we also need to change this regular expression to accept JSX and TSX extensions. So here I will swap the J for a group that accepts either T or J, and after the S I add an X followed by a question mark. And this means first a dot, then a J or a T, then S, and then X, which can occur or not. And I save a file. Another thing we need to set up is in the bubble configuration file. In the file tree, there is a hidden file called .bubble.rc, and inside it we need to specify the two presets we have just installed. So add the two package names, @bubble/preset-typescript and @bubble/preset-react, and then save a file. And this should be all we need to render React components. So let's try to render a Hello World React component. In the assets/js directory, I create a new directory and I call it todo app in camel case. And inside this directory, I will create a new file and I call it index.tsx. And this will be the main file of our React application. So inside it, let's import React from React and define a new functional component, const todo app equals, and here I define an arrow function that returns an h1 element and with a text hello from React. And in the end of the file, I export default todo app. Now that we have defined our first component, let's try to actually render it on the page. So when you go to the terminal and try to run Webpack by typing run yarn watch, we see that we run into an error because the file app.tsx that we defined in as the entry point of our application does not yet exist. So I will go back to the editor, and in the file tree, I rename the app.js file to app.tsx. And there should be no error now, so I go up one level to the root folder of our Phoenix application, and I run the server by typing mix.phx.server. And we see that the server is listening and that our webpack has started compiling. So when we go back to the browser, we see that the application still looks like before. And this is expected because we have never explicitly told the JavaScript to actually render a component. So I will leave the editor on the left and the browser on the right. And in the and let me first get rid of all this default boilerplate content. And one part of it is in the layouts. So I go up one folder to lib, to do list, web, templates, layout, and app. HTML EEX, and when we scroll down, we see that there is this header, and I basically delete all the header and everything that's inside. So on the right, we see that the header had disappeared, and now I will open the other template, which is page/index.html.ex, and let me just delete everything inside this file. And when I save it, we see that everything disappeared on the page, and this is just as expected. And as you know, React needs a container to actually render. So let me create a div for it, and I will give it the ID of todo app. And I close the tag. And now we see that it still looks exactly the same. But when we open the source, we see that there is a div that we can use. So in the app.tsx file, I will also delete everything inside because we will not need it at the moment. And in here, I import React from React, and then I import React DOM from React DOM. And now I will import the todo app from ./todo app. And now still nothing should change because there is no reason to change. And below it, I will write a function that will actually render the application. So document add event listener. This means that the function that follows we run after the DOM content has been loaded. So there is an event called DOM content loaded. And as the second argument of this function, I pass an arrow function. And inside this function, I will first find the container on the page. So container const container
equals document get element by ID, and we gave it the ID of todo app. A common mistake is passing the element's ID to get document get element by ID with a pound symbol like this, but don't do it because this is a habit from jQuery times. So in here it's just like this, get document get element by ID, and we pass it to do app. And then if the container does not exist, then we don't do anything. And then we can call React DOM render. And the first thing we need to pass it is the to do app as a React component, and the second argument will be container. So when we save it, on the right we see hello from React, and this means that the application is rendering. And the last point I would like to cover in this video is styling. So when we look at the browser window right now, we see that the text is still nicely styled with a default styling that came with the Phoenix framework. And the way styles are processed in this configuration of Webpack is that in your JavaScript, you import a CSS file, and then it goes through a Webpack plugin that extracts all the CSS and it puts it in a separate CSS bundle. However, if we take a look at the app.tsx file, we see that there is nowhere that imports that CSS file right now. Let's import this file again. I'll go to the top of the file and import .css/app.css. And it still looks exactly the same. So let's go to app.css and delete everything that's inside this file. So right now we see that there is no styling anymore. So just to see if this is working, I will add some styles. And body margin 0, padding 0, and font family Helvetica and sans serif. And we see that the styles get applied. And now that this is working, let's set up Sass. Let's switch back to the terminal. For now, let's just close this Phoenix server and cd into the assets directory. And we will need to install three dev dependencies. So I type yarn add dash capital D node sass style loader sass loader. And in here, NodeSass is the Sass preprocessor, and StyleLoader and SassLoader are two libraries that Webpack uses to process our files. So let's flip back to the Webpack configuration. And in this section, we need to update the regular expression, because right now it only accepts CSS files, and we know that Sass comes with the extensions .sass and .scss. So first I add an S, and I swap the C for a group that accepts either C or A. And I save a file, and in this loader configuration, we need to first add style loader, and this goes before mini CSS extract plugin. And in the end, I add sass loader. This won't really do anything because right now our file is still in pure CSS. So let's rename this file to app.scss. In app.tsx, we need to update this import. And let's restart the server. And the tab updated, and it still looks exactly the same. So let's see if a Sass features actually work. So I'll flip back to app.scss, and inside body, I will now add a nested block that says font size 72 pixels and color salmon. And this way, the text should become really big and salmon colored. So I think this concludes our video, and in the following parts we will install Apollo Boost, and we will configure the GraphQL client, and we will start implementing some features. So that's it, and if you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe, and if you didn't, leave some feedback in the comments below. Thank you.